All right, good morning to each of you. I'd like to continue on in the series that we've been talking about for a little while now. And these messages are actually messages that I shared last week at SMBI. And so this is one that I have not done here. And I'd like to go ahead and do that. But if you will, let's turn to Matthew chapter 16. And I'd like to read, starting at verse 13, and we'll read through 19. Let's all stand, and we'll read these verses together, and then just remain standing, and we'll have a word of prayer. Matthew 16, and we'll start at verse 13. All right, all together. When Jesus came into the coast of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, saying, "Whom do men say that I, the Son of Man, am?" And they said, "Some say that thou art John the Baptist, some Elias, and others Jeremias, or one of the prophets." He saith unto them, "But whom say ye that I am?" And Simon Peter answered and said, "Thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God." And Jesus answered and said unto him, "Blessed art thou, Simon Barjona, for flesh and blood hath not revealed it unto thee, but my Father which is in heaven. And I say also unto thee that thou art Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. And I will give unto thee the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatsoever thou shalt bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatsoever thou shalt loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven." Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for this day, and we thank you for your love and your faithfulness. We thank you for this passage of Scripture. Lord, I pray that you would just be with us, your Holy Spirit would guide us, and just as we look at this over the next few moments, we pray for you to bless us and lead us in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, you can be seated. Okay, so you see a picture up here, and this picture was actually taken when we were over in Israel in 2022. This is Caesarea Philippi, and this is pretty much possibly as it would have been without minus some of these railings and maybe that building up there with the fence. I think that's a bit of a water treatment or something. I'm not sure, but this is Caesarea Philippi. This is probably one of the most important places in Christendom. And why is that? And so I want to go ahead and talk about it just a little bit. Caesarea Philippi in those days was probably one of the most vile, wicked places in their region. Caesarea Philippi was known for idolatry and gross idolatry. There, if you look, not sure, this picture doesn't have it, but off to the side, yeah, there it is. There's one niche. That was a spot where they would have an image of a god sitting. If you keep on going, there's some larger ones that are actually over, kind of off this picture. But they worshiped, there was the god Zeus was worshiped there, but also there was a god Pan, and Pan was the goat god. And in this place was some of the most, there was a large temple structure, and this is like really up close. There's a large temple structure that there was some of the most vile, wicked things that we won't even speak about today. There were thousands of prostitutes. In one of these niches over here, they said they would have a brazen image that they would put a fire under it, and they would put babies in it, and they would have infant sacrifice. There would be things going on, and these prostitutes would have children, and they would sacrifice these children, and they would throw them. This spot right here is a place that's called the Gates of Hell. That's its name. It's a deep, deep pit. Some in their mythology, they said it's bottomless. Out of this pit in the springtime flows water. It will flow, and there will be in April, starting now, there will be water flowing out of there, and it'll be lush. But when we were there in August, the end of August, the beginning of September, it was dry. But out of it, but they would take and throw infants that were conceived the previous year in their big celebration, and they would take them and throw them into that place called the gates of hell, because they wanted to appease the gods, and they wanted to get favor for their crops. There was just so much wickedness there that Jewish people were not permitted to go to Caesarea Philippi. As I understand it, it was a place that was off limits. I can very well imagine, as Jesus took his disciples to that spot and sat there, he asked them this question. And I think I want us to just think about this, because it gives us some background and gives us some understanding of actually what Christ had in mind for his church. He said, "Whom do men say that I, the Son of Man, am?" So think about this in this setting, as he's sitting there looking at this place of just vile wickedness. And I'm sure they're sitting off to the side somewhere, not taking part in it. But he said, "Whom do men say that I am?" And they said, "Some say thou art John the Baptist, Elijah, Jeremiah, or one of the prophets." And then he said, "But whom say ye that I am?" And Simon Peter answered and said, "Thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God." He said that in a setting where there was a lot of worship of so-called gods. And Jesus said this to him. He said, "Blessed art thou, Simon Barjona, for flesh and blood hath not revealed it unto thee, but my Father which is in heaven." Okay? So that's the setting of Jesus talking to his disciples. Flesh and blood didn't reveal this to you. This is something bigger going on. He said, thou art Peter. And this verse here has given the church so much confusion for centuries, because they don't understand. I didn't understand the setting. Think about it like this. This could very easily have been the way that it was done. Peter is the one who said, "Thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God." And then Jesus said, "Flesh and blood didn't reveal this." He said, "Thou art Peter." And then he says, "Upon this rock." And he probably pointed to that rock. And he says, "I will build my church, and the gates of hell cannot prevail against it." I wasn't there, so I can't say it, but I have listened to people talk about it and explain it, that this is, the gates of hell is a very real place. That's a spot that you can't see it, but it's protected. You can't get in there. You can see this. You can see that hole and that opening. But I think what Jesus was saying is that there is no wickedness. There's no debauchery. There's no vileness that can stand against my church. This is the first time that the church was mentioned. This is the first time Jesus mentioned his church. And he said, the gates of hell cannot prevail against it. Now, think with me just a little bit. There's a lot of examples we can pull from this. But the gates of hell is not a... it's not an offensive place. I mean, it is very offensive to sensible human beings, yes. But it's not some place that's going to be coming and walking out into the rest of society. Jesus said, "I will build my church, and there is nothing that is going to prevail against it." So what he's saying is that his church is supposed to be an offensive organism. That's what Jesus was saying. And I've said that here before, that the church is not supposed to be a defensive-minded, protect-at-all-cost type of organization. The church is supposed to be on the offense. And so when God gives us a vision or a passion or a burden, let's do it. Let's take the power that He's given us and let's attack. If we want to go against abortion, if we want to go against drug abuse, if we want to go against alcoholism, if we want to go against homelessness, we actually have the authority to do it. Jesus said, the gates of hell can't prevail against it. And so as I was thinking about this in light of what is our role, this is another one of the principles of Mission Command. And just for a little bit of a quick review, Mission Command is actually a military term. It's actually being used more and more in the world today in armies, because the old method of command and control, which is still being utilized, is becoming less and less effective in a world where the enemy is all around you. Command and control works very well when you have a front line and you can go to it, and the enemies are on this side and the allies are on this side. But now the world is just all integrated, and there's trouble attacking from everywhere. And so that's the situation that the Israeli Defense Force finds itself in. And so they've adopted Mission Command. But it's fascinating to me, as I study this, each of the principles of Mission Command are principles that are applicable to the church and to Christian life. And so is it right, or is it okay, to use non-resistant terms to affect and talk about the Christian life? I believe it is. And I have it on good authority, because the Apostle Paul did it. He talked about boxing. He talked about other things that weren't non-resistant. But I believe there's some things in here. When we think about the weapons of our warfare, they're not carnal, but they're mighty. We have the opportunity to be involved in warfare. And so the one I want to talk about today is commander's intent. And thinking about Jesus Christ being our commander, what was His intent for the church? And He set it up, and I believe He's telling us here, I'm going to build My church, and the gates of hell can't prevail against it. I want My church to be an organism that goes throughout this life and through this world and transforms it and brings it into one with Me. That's His goal and His purpose. And as I think about Caesarea Philippi and what did Christ have in mind when He took His disciples to this place that was off limits? It's kind of like think how uncomfortable you would feel in many of the things that happened in Las Vegas, Nevada, in our experience. You know, they say what happens in Vegas stays in Vegas. I think what happened in Caesarea Philippi stayed in Caesarea Philippi. It was a place of not a good place. Jesus took His disciples there to tell them, this is what I have in mind for My church. What is His intent? What is His purpose? I think this is what is Christ's purpose. And I think I may have used this saying before, but if you could lay, this is not my thought, but if you could lay your head on God's chest, this is what you'd hear, and you'd hear His heartbeat. He wants all to be saved, none to perish. Just think about it like this. All to be saved, none to perish. All to be saved, none to perish. There's not anyone in our experience that we meet that God doesn't love. and that he doesn't want to have be part of his kingdom. But for some reason, and this kind of goes along with our Sunday school lesson day, he chose us to get the message out. Now, why did he do that? I mean, we get so mixed up and messed up sometimes, but he still chose us to get this message out. We have a big responsibility. You know, I found a little slide here that kind of represents what the church is supposed to be, a gate crashing force to be reckoned with. This is a gate that somehow got run over. I mean, just think about it. If the gates of hell cannot prevail against the church, gates are not going to stand. So thinking about how should we represent ourselves? What should the church look like? This is a picture, and they say a picture is worth a thousand words. This is a picture of a battleship. And that battleship is out somewhere. I'm not sure where the picture was taken, but it's out, and there's guns bristling. There's a lot of activity that you can't see in this picture. A battleship is all hands on deck. Everyone has a job, everyone has a task, and they know what they're doing. The battleship is, I believe, what the church should be represented as. There's another picture I have here, something totally different. That is a cruise ship, where you basically have maybe 5% of the occupants on board this beautiful boat are serving the rest of the 95% of the occupants. Tell me if that doesn't sound like the church sometimes, where people come together and they fellowship and they're involved in all manner of recreation, and the people who are the people who are leading are the ones doing the work. That's not the way Christ had it set up. Christ has it set up for everyone to be engaged in the battle, not a cruise ship. It's supposed to be a battleship, and that's what he has in mind. So I want this picture to rivet in your mind. Battleship, cruise ship, what are we? What should the church be? And so when Christ was giving his instructions, his commander's intent, I came across this quote from David Marquette, who was actually a naval submarine captain who took part, he took command of a submarine that was not doing very, very poorly. He has a book that he wrote called Turn This Ship Around. Really fascinating story it's a book that I have. And he said, if you want your people to think, don't give instructions, give intent. And I think that's what Jesus did. Jesus gave us his intent. How are we to flesh it out? I believe that's what we need to do. We need to work together and figure out a way to flesh it out. So what is, David Marquette actually put this thought into action. And in less than a year, his submarine went from being at the bottom of the, no pun intended, at the bottom of the fleet until the very best top performing submarine, as I understand it. And as in performing, everyone knew their job, everyone did their job, and people cared about their ship. And some of the ways that was represented were officers. They went from having pretty much zero officers being transferred forward. I'm trying to think of the word, promoted. Officers promoted until they had hundreds of men were promoted in underneath his care. People re-enlisting. They only had three or four re-enlisting per year until he came. And at that point in time, it was almost all of them would re-enlist when their tour of duty was over. Just a complete change. But if you want your people to think, don't give instructions, give intent. And basically, he went from giving orders, command and control, that was their previous experience, to basically giving them the shared understanding that we had talked about before. We talked about the risk acceptance. Those are things that took place. Very, very fascinating story. But that's how the church should function. It should not be an organism that's led by people giving orders. It's going to be led by Jesus Christ, and we all are part of the battle and part of the warfare. Commander's intent is a clear and concise expression of the purpose of an operation, the desired outcome, the acceptable risk for achieving mission success. Most often, the commander's intent is delivered in some meeting to squadron leadership. This is what our commander had to say when he left this world. Some of the last words that he spoke to his disciples as they met there on the mountain, as ascension. And he left, he said, "All authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Go therefore and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things that I've commanded you. And lo, I'm with you always, even to the end of the age. Amen." That's what he wanted. That's his goal. That's his task for us. And interesting, inside of commander's intent, there are three elements. And all of these are extremely relevant to us. What is our purpose? What's our purpose for being here? Why should we complete this task? Why personnel must complete the assignment? That's the purpose. What is the key task? What is the objective or the goal? What are we trying to accomplish while we're here? Is it, and the end state, what should the result look like? And as I studied this and thought about it, my mind went to, what is the end state? What are we looking for as we walk in this earth, in this life? Anyone? We do. Ultimately, we want them to be reconciled with Christ. We want His purposes to be accomplished in this world. Think with me, Brandon's talked about it already, the Garden of Eden. That was Christ's original purpose for this world, the Garden of Eden, where man could live in a place of beauty and where there wasn't trash, a place where we could accomplish things and be at one, reconciled with God. That's what the result should look like. Isaiah 26, 1 to 4, gives us a picture. "In that day shall this song be sung in the land of Judah. We have a strong city. Salvation will he appoint for walls and bulwarks. Open ye the gates, that the righteous nation which keepeth faith may enter in. Thou wilt keep him in perfect peace, whose mind is stayed on thee, because he trusteth in thee. Trust ye in Jehovah forever. For in Jehovah, even Jehovah, is an everlasting rock." This word I have underlined is peace. That is actually the Hebrew word shalom. And shalom is a word that is what Christ has in mind. It's Hebrew. And shalom means reconciled, restored, at one. You know, we have the English word peace. And when we think about peace, there's a number of things that may come to our mind. Peace can be called, There's been numerous peace treaties in the Middle East, but do they really have peace? Sometimes it's just avoiding conflict. And the person who has the biggest fist or the biggest gun or the most might can enforce peace. He can make people behave. But what is true peace? True peace is what I think Jesus is talking about in the Sermon on the Mount. He said, blessed are the peacemakers, the people who actually help reconcile each other together, and they come into one with Christ. And so the Greeks did not have that word, shalom. They have, here's one in, this is written in Greek, John 14, 27. Peace I leave with you, my peace I give unto you, not as the world giveth, give I unto you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. That's peace that's mentioned in the New Testament. It's Greek, but their word is, the Greek word is, I believe, irene. Yeah, irene. But true peace is making all things new. And I'd like to just read, kind of here in closing, Revelation 21, 1 to 5. This is what I believe Christ has in mind. The end state. You know, when you think about, we had creation, and then there was a fall. Then there was redemption, and ultimately restoration. And so, as I think about in the Great Commission, what should be involved in this restoration? I think we need to think very strategically about everything that we do should be involved in restoration. And it should be our business. It should be our witnessing. It should be our recreation. How can that be part of restoration? Our purpose, our goals need to be making disciples, because we want them to become restored with the Creator. And I saw a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth were passed away, and there was no more sea. And I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down from God out of heaven, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them. And they shall be his people, and God himself shall be with them and be their God. And God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes, and there shall be no more death, neither sorrow nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain. For the former things are passed away. And he that sat upon the throne said, behold, I make all things new. That's the end state of the commander's intent. He wants to make all things new. Can we partner with him? Can we be a part of that process? I have an artist's rendering of the Garden of Eden. I don't know, but that's very beautiful and it's very peaceful. It's one person's idea, but can we make that be reality in our world? I think that's what our commander has asked us to do. He wants us to help restore.